Today we commence another 7 days of program, which is of a different nature altogether. Here, we do not merely enjoy a tasteful dish through the feelings of the heart, but at the same time exercise our mind in the direction of our true blessedness. Where does our blessedness actually lie? Where do we become complete persons? These are days when people are intensely conscious of the environment of the world. Environment is very important. The vast atmosphere around us, which is the environment, not only influences us minute by minute every day, but on a careful analysis we will realize that we are inseparable from this environment. The environment spoken of is a kind of society external to us. We know very well to what extent every person is dependent on external human society and the society of nature. The air that we breathe, the water that we drink, and the sunlight that we bask ourselves upon. It is not merely this much. There are greater secrets which never appear before our eyes. Namely, the question of our existence itself. Do we exist? If it is true that we are existing, where are we existing? Where are you coming from? We generally ask a person. People say, I am coming from Delhi, from Kanyakumari, from Japan, from England, Europe, America. But whatever be the place from where you are coming, it amounts to saying that you are coming from the surface of the earth only. You are moving on the surface of the earth. There are no countries actually speaking. They don't exist at all. They are only conceptual demarcations of the human mind for purpose of administrative convenience. Countries do not exist. Only the surface of the earth exists. The language that we speak, which immensely conditions our cultural background, adds to the difficulty of our not being able to realize that we are citizens of this planet Earth, let alone the question of nationalities and countries. We cling even to a community, a village. A district, and imagine that we are confined to that particular location. the mind has a predilection to enjoy limitations of its own self, shrinking itself more and more into a very, very limited cocoon of prejudiced individuality, so that this little tiny dot of a so-called I within oneself feels immensely happy within the torturous cell of its own bodily encasement. The environment that we are speaking of is what is external to us from one point of view, but inseparable from us from another point of view. While this earth is a large planet upon the surface of which we are crawling like insects, as it were, the earth is a member of the larger family of the planetary system, which is ruled by the great parent of the entire system called the solar operation. Our family extends to the entire galaxies. Which are the original sources of different solar systems? Magnetic forces, which are undividedly pervading the whole atmosphere, taking often the form of what generally people call cosmic rays, which are not actually rays but magnetic energies flowing from outer space, solidify themselves into the visible forms of bodily existence of human beings, of trees, of mountains, and the very earth itself. The cosmological analysis, even on a purely empirical level, establishes the fact that the vibration of space created a movement which we call the activity of air pervading the surface of the earth. Friction caused by this continuous movement of the air principle created heat we call fire. The further condensation of the density of these forces, right from the activity of space, becomes what we call liquid, the solidified form of which is this very earth. That is to say, our family extends beyond the surface of this earth, touches the planets, the sun, the moon and the stars. Have you heard that our minds operate according to the movement of the moon in the sky? Lunar waxing and waning cause waxing and waning of the feelings and emotions in the minds of people. During full moon and new moon days, people generally get excited. without themselves knowing what actually is happening to them. On full moon days, the ocean waves rise up as if they want to catch the moon itself. The gravitational pull of the moon makes the liquid of the ocean rise up into turbulent waves. It does not follow that the ocean alone is pulled by the gravitational power of the moon. The whole earth is pulled. Because the earth is solid, it does not rise up like the wave of the waters of the ocean. But nevertheless, the pull is uniformly felt by every particle of the material stuff of this earth. What of ourselves? We are also pulled up. The waters of the sea are pulled up, every cell of our body also is pulled up. We get agitated, disturbed, upset, and have changing moods. And people who have a deficient mind, not perfectly normal, behave erratically, excitedly, and abnormally during full moon and new moon. The lunacy of the mind comes from the word luna, which means the moon. We say the person is lunatic, that is moonstruck. Just as there is sunstroke, there can be moonstroke also. In that case, there is disturbance caused by the mind. Astrologically, if any one of you knows something of astrology, we can decide the condition of the mind of a person from the location of the moon in the horoscope. Where is that moon situated? In what context? In what corner? In what relationship with other planets? Suffice it to say, we are not simply causally existing here independently by ourselves in our locked up rooms. This idea has to be shed. We do not belong to our own selves. If it is true that we have to love our own neighbor, we have to know who our neighbor is. A question was asked of Jesus Christ. Master, you said love thy neighbor as thyself, but who is my neighbor? How would you know who is your neighbor? That which is adjacent to you, that which is almost touching you, that which is inseparable from you, it limits you, conditions you, from whom you derive benefit, and about which you have some fear even. You like your neighbor because the neighbor may be of assistance to you under certain conditions, but you fear your neighbor also, because the neighbor can retort and retaliate and behave in a manner contrary to your expectations. So the neighbor is a friendly being and also a fearsome something. So is nature. Nothing can be more friendly to us than vast nature, because it is the mother out of which we are born. The very stuff of our body is made up of the five elements: earth, water, fire, air and ether. If that is the case, how do we consider ourselves as outwardly existing external to nature? The very building bricks of this body, of our own selves, are the stuff of the five elements. We do not say that there is space, there is a long distance of sky between ourselves and the solar orb. Don't say that, because the sky or the space that you speak of is the very same thing that is causing the width and the height of this body. The size of our personality is due to the space that is present within us. Scientists tell us that if you squeeze out all the space from within our body, the entire stuff of our body will be 1 cubic millimeter of carbon, hydrogen and all that. There is nothing in us. We are puffed up, puffed balloons due to the entry of space within us. Balloon looks big, so we also look big. But it is all air that is causing this expansion of the balloon. The space that is within us is the reason for our height and width. Our very existence is precariously conditioned by the structural pattern of the whole atmosphere outside, so that we do not know who is really there, whether the nature outside is existing or we are existing. If the house that is built is not independent of the bricks of which it is constructed, independent of the cement and the iron rod that we use, and it will not be existing there if you pull out the bricks, you can say there is no such thing as a house. It is only a false name that you give to a spatial shape taken by the bricks and the cement and the substance that has gone into the formation of that particular structure. There are no mansions, no palaces, no houses, but only bricks, stones and cement and lime, etc., etc. In a similar manner, question will arise, do we really exist at all? Or we are imagining that we are like mansions, parading ourselves. These mansions will collapse when the building bricks are pulled out. That happens at a time when we call the departure of the spirit of our personality from this particular formation called the earth. The elements withdraw themselves in their erstwhile cooperation with us. The power of cohesion which keeps these bricks in order so that we may feel safe in this body. This cohesive force destabilizes itself and they go helter-skelter. Just as the cement that is keeping the bricks together will not be there, the bricks will collapse in 1 minute. The cohesive force is our ahankara, our egoism, our self-assertive nature. So intensely are we conscious of this limitation of the bodily existence, that power of that affirmation. You know, mind is very powerful. It is the electromagnetic energy that can draw everything into itself. Nothing can be stronger than mind. Nothing is more powerful than mind. And nothing can be more enduring than the mind. The self-affirmation of a little location of mental process, which is what is called the I in the individual sense, acts as a cohesive force of the particles of nature and causes the formation of this little body. And we differ from one another in our structure, in our face, in our eyes, in our very demeanor, because of the nature of the difference between the affirmation in one person and another. We don't assert ourselves equally, and therefore we do not look identical with one another. Our desires vary. Actually, what we call this cohesive force is nothing but the mind's desire. No two persons will desire the same thing. Though they appear to be desiring one and the same thing, for instance, the manner in which the desire manifests itself differs. That is why there are so many people in this world. Otherwise, if only one person, if there is only one kind of desire, there will be only a mass of humanity merged into one Vishwarupa of man. That doesn't happen. Suffice it to say, therefore, that we are not existing in any particular location of the world. Our atmosphere is our neighbor, and when it is said that we should love our neighbor, we love our own larger personality. We cannot love an alien entity. If the neighbor has no connection with you, in any manner whatsoever, the question of loving the neighbor does not arise. There is a vitality or similarity of characteristic between oneself and the neighbor. Therefore, the question of loving or having any relationship with the neighbor arises. The world is our neighbor. It is not merely near us. It is that stuff out of which we are made. As I mentioned to you, the substance of nature constitutes the stuff of our physical personality. The cosmic mind is operating and dancing through the individual mind of every one of us. The solar orb conditions the eyes, moon conditions the mind, and many other divine forces are conditioned in the operation of the sense organs. We do not seem to be independently existing at all. We seem to be living a borrowed existence. There are people who live by borrowing and they have nothing of their own. In a similar manner, we live a borrowed existence, and when the creditor withdraws support, the entire sustenance will collapse in 1 second and the whole individual personality will get dismembered into little bits of material stuff and reduced to the utter particles of nature. The vast stellar system above, which also forms part and parcel of the conditioning factors of our existence, is a matter that you will consider. Why do you consult people who know the stars? What is my stars? Ashwini Bharani Kritika and all that. Why do you worry about the stars? The stars are inside your body. Through their operations, which is non-spatial in their nature. Space is extended as it were and is causing a dimension of distance, all which makes us believe that the stars are far, far away from us. It is not so. It is like saying that the head is far away from the toe. In one sense it is true. There is a distance of 5.5 feet or 6 feet from the toe to the head. This distance does not matter. We do not feel that distance. Do you feel that you are having a head which is far away from your toe? That integrating power which is of I-ness in you abolishes the apparent distance measurable geometrically from the toe to the head. That one is not taken into consideration because of an awareness that brings the distance into a non-entity and nullity. There is therefore a cosmic cohesive force which you may call cosmic mind or the divinity operating everywhere, which is actually the reason why we are existing as we are existing. We live in this world through this body, in this body, only so long as our assertive nature of our false independence continues. When that is lifted up, we won't exist at all. I made reference to this particular principleness and designated these principles as desires. An intense longing to be in one place only, and a desire to be for some time only, and to be connected to certain things only, and not to all things. This is the limitation that is part and parcel of the I consciousness or the affirming individuality of ours. We require liberation. People say we want moksha, salvation. For which purpose we are to practice sadhana? What is the kind of moksha that we are aspiring for? liberation from the thraldom of this assumed individuality of a physical existence conditioned by sensory organs. It is actually the longing. Mutsutva means the desire to melt down this falsely manufactured individuality in the maelstrom, the oceanic expanse of universal nature. When you become all nature yourself, your moksha is granted to you. Moksha is the freedom from the shackle of individuality, from the limitations of particularized existence, and the sorrow that is gnawing into our vitals on account of this false identification. If you are in one place only, if you are the son or daughter of some person only, and if you are speaking some language only, if that is the case, that is your business. The world is not concerned with it, and you can expect no benefit from the world of nature, because you are one person's son, one person's daughter, one language you speak, you are existing in one place only. If this kind of egoistic affirmation continues, world will kick you out and will benefit you in no way whatsoever. Even God cannot help a person who is refusing to accept the existence of God's existence. If you don't accept it, it won't be accept you also. If you don't want to accept that there is a thing that is outside you, it also will not accept your existence. There will be a war between outer nature and individual personality. Moksha, liberation, is just simple thing. It is an enlargement of the consciousness into the dimension of the widest possible extent until it reaches a point where it overcomes even the idea of space and time. This is to think in a totally different way altogether. The greatest education is the art of the chastening of the mind. There is no use of studying textbooks and going into the tomes of science, philosophy and scripture. Our friend is our mind. The books cannot help us. Whatever we have learned from outside sources will leave us because they are outside us. Our mind is our friend. Our mind is our treasure. The mind is not merely a thought. It is also a thing by itself. Thoughts are also things. It is something new that you have to hear from anybody. The thought, the process of the function of the mind can concretize itself into a form, assume a substantiality of its own as it appears in dream, for instance. Hard rocks and mountains and rivers you can see in the dream world. You can hit your head against a rock and the forehead can bleed even in dream, because the stuff of the mind which has projected the solidity of the object of perception can cause a similar experience. What is happening to us in the waking state is similar to the thing that is happening in the dream world. Objects do not exist independently of the thought process. The relationship between the all-pervading mind, the cosmic mind and the individual mind is actually the relationship between man and God, the individual and the absolute. What we require is therefore an interstraining of our own mind and enabling the mind to think in terms of its vast potentialities. The all-pervading mind is the source of the individual droplets of minds apparently working within the brain and skull of different individuals. The ocean operates through all the drops of water in the little mini globules of eruptions on its surface. These little globules of drops or ocean only. So is the case with our mind, which are droplets of cosmic mind. If a particular drop in the ocean is to assume individuality by itself and assert that it is totally unconnected to the ocean, it is free to think like that, and it becomes an isolated, bifurcated, unwanted individuality. To attain moksha, so much time is necessary as it is necessary for a drop in the ocean to sink into the ocean. How much time it requires? It is only to realize that it is inseparable from the ocean. We have a fad and a prejudice of thinking that the individuality of ours is all in all. Not knowing the fact, we cannot even exist without contribution of support from nature outside and the vast atmosphere. Environment is this much. The environment we are speaking of which so much is talked about these days, is not merely the trees and the waters and the air that we breathe, but the entire atmosphere touching beyond the very point of the existence of stars. These bodies not only are made up of 5 elements, of the elements of the different planets, but of stars themselves. That is why we are so much concerned with the operation of the planets through our body, and we always talk about the stars into which a person is born, and so on and so forth. So such a distant thing for the star and the planet seems to be exerting such influence on ourselves that we are cosmically constituted is a fact that does not require much of an explanation. This is a great revelation. Can you think like this? That you cannot exist like this as you are thinking that you are existing. That if the bricks of your body can be pulled out by that source which has contributed its own substance into yourself. But the prejudice of human nature is so hard, flint-like, that it will not permit you to think even what is best for you. The poet has beautifully said, the egoism asserts, it is better to be a king in hell than a servant in heaven. Let it be heaven, but why should I be a servant sweeping the floor of the palace of the gods? Let it be hell, does not matter, but I will be the ruler. Such is the way in which ahankara operates, egoism acts, and personality consciousness kills us particularly. We kill ourselves by the erroneous thinking process, the terrible flint-like ahankara that is what we seem to be ourselves. We have nothing in us except our egoism. Every moment we assert it, subconsciously, consciously, or otherwise. The individuality of yours, the egoism of yours, can not be known by you when you are not interfered with. Let somebody scratch you, you can know what you are. The egoism will hiss like a serpent and it will tell that person who you are. Any interference from externality of any kind, even from your brother, you will not tolerate, because you are what you are and you cannot be anything else different from what you are. I am what I am. If this is the affirmation of our isolated individuality, there is no question of liberation. Unless you want liberation, it cannot come. Mumukshutva is a longing for it. There is no other qualification necessary. There is only one qualification, you should want it. Your heart should want it. And you will realize that the psychology of the mind is such that anything that you really want has to come to you. But you should be really 100% want. You should not desultorily and half-heartedly want a thing. If it comes, let it come. If it doesn't come, does not matter. Then it won't come. You should say it will come and it has to come. Because the mind is nothing but the object that you think of. The mind is touching the object. When you say it has to come, it comes. Whoever thinks of me deeply, undividedly, to such a person, I provide everything and take care of whatever is so provided. He is a great promise that we read in one of the verses of the Bhagavad Gita. It is the whole world speaking to you. Eternity is speaking to the temporal world. You think of the eternal, the whole temporal world will fall at your feet. That is the meaning of this great verse. Ananya chintayanto mam yajana pariyupasate tesham nitya bhayutanam yogakshemam vahami. It is not the son of Vasudeva or Devaki, Krishna, that is speaking. And Krishna is only a symbolic mouthpiece of this whole universe speaking to you. Come unto me and I shall give you whatever you need. The whole universe is speaking to you. That is what is called Vishwarupa, which Bhagavan Sri Krishna showed. The entire cosmos is talking to you. Come unto me, I shall give you what you want. But you are telling it, you go away from here, I mind my business. Then how will you get anything? You shall be permanently poverty stricken, sorrowing, because you do not want, that's all. If you do not want anything, how will it come? Even wanting is not possible. We are so poor that we cannot even want something that is blessed. The mind is so treacherous, so such a trickster, that it won't allow you even to want the thing that you want. You very desultorily and suspiciously ask for God. Will it come? Maybe or may not be. Even this birth is not possible. He may not be existing there. This may be a concussion of the Pandits. Who knows? This nothing will come. Doubts are our traitors. If there is any dacoit in this world, it is doubt in your mind. You doubt your own self. You doubt the capacity of your own mind. You don't trust your own self. How will you trust anybody else? If you have full trust in yourself, if you are true to your own self, if you are honest to your own self, and if you are confident that you have got the infinite potentiality of summoning the forces of nature, they will be at your beck and call. That is what Bhagavan Sri Krishna mentioned, I shall be with you. I shall be at your beck and call. I shall sweep your floor. I shall wash your clothes. I shall provide you rations. Who is actually speaking? The whole cosmos is telling you, come my dear child, I am here to provide you with whatever you want. But we don't want. Then how will it come? So Mumukshutva is longing for the liberation from this limited thraldom of individual physical existence and a deep wanting. You have to underline the word wanting. Do you want? You will get it. Be sure about it. Hari Om Tat Sat. God bless you.